use the calculator. There are a lot of functions on the calculator that you're supposed to be knowing. And before I start, people have a little resilience towards using this calculator because they somehow find the scientific calculator to be easier. One, because you can see the brackets on the scientific calculator and you cannot view the brackets on this calculator over here. So it's just, I'll just tell you one thing, that even I used to use scientific calculator as everybody before, you know, class for class 11 and 12 and for college and etc. But once you start using financial calculator, you'll not be able to use scientific calculator. So it's less about the calculator and more about the habit. So get into the habit of using this financial calculator, because anyways you're going to be using it in all the levels and all the financial exams, be it CFA, be it FRM, be it CAIA, be it even the other exams, are going to be using a very standardized these calculators only. And the kind of functions and the amount of calculations and the amount of output you can derive from this calculator is amazing, is really amazing. So make sure you guys are comfortable with using this calculator. What I'll do is, first of all, I'll tell you all the important functions that we generally use, and then I'll also discuss the other functions that you may use if you feel like, or you may skip if you don't like to do so. So it'll be your choice if you want to use a particular function or not use a particular function. So that'll be your choice. But there are certain functions which you have to be comfortable with, and maybe two or three functions I'll just leave it out, because that's a very little complicated, it'll take a lot of time and you'll not be using it anyhow in any of these exams. So let's start off with these functions over here. So first of all, you have the Texas Instruments calculator. Texas Instrument is what you're going to be using for all your exams, and that you have only two models which is allowed for your examinations: Texas Instrument BA2+ or BA2+ Professional. The difference between BA2+ and BA2+ Professional is very, very minimal. So there is not much of an issue out there, and the buttons are exactly the same. Within the buttons, maybe a couple of functions might be missing on the non-professional version. And otherwise, the professional version is a plastic, is a metal body, as you can see over here. For a lot of you, mine is an old calculator. It's about 8-10 years. So, 8 years or something, and you could be having a plastic version of the calculator, the buttons would be the same, and the metal body also, people might be having a black colored metal calculator, metal bodied professional calculator. So that just would be the difference in color, and nothing else has changed. And also, since I've mentioned the 7-8 years, the reason was that you don't need to worry about carrying batteries and all in the exam, because it's not going to be such that you know, the battery is going to suddenly die off, because I have never changed my battery in over these 8-9 years. Make sure you're buying a genuine calculator so that there is no issues out there. And second, what since obviously there, I have heard students, you know, that their calculators stopped working or something like that. At times it is possible. It's not I would not ask you to spend and buy to keep two calculators per person, but what you could do would be that between 5, 7, 8, 10 friends, you could have at least one person who has an extra calculator. So in case of an examination, you know, okay, this friend is carrying two. So between 5, 7, 8 people, you could at least have one calculator spare extra, which you're carrying for the exams. So that in case of, you know, in the lunch break, if everybody's calculator would be working fine, hopefully. But in case, you at least know whom to ask that, okay, this person has a spare calculator in case there is any problem in the between the morning afternoon session for CFA, or, you know, in case people are appearing for both the FRM part 1 and 2 together. So you can, in that section, you can ask for a change in calculator. Or you could ask the proctor in case she allows you to take another calculator out of the bag. So at least you know someone who has an extra calculator. You could do that. That's your choice. Anyways, moving forward with the calculator, let's start off with the basics. So your on and off button, you understand, it's simple. But the part is that even if you switch off your calculator and switch on your calculator a week later or 2 weeks later, the data that was stored wherever in whatever positions on the calculator will remain to be over there. So until and unless you clear a data from a particular area, even switching off a calculator and switching on the calculator will not help you. Everybody with me? And the CEC button is just to clear. So in case I'm writing a 50+6 on the screen, suppose I press CEC, that is your clear work. That's as it is in your normal calculator. Switch off and switch on is simple, you understand. This one is going to be a backspace. So say for example, I'm typing 98.25. I need a backspace, again a backspace for decimal, 980.25. So your backspace works on the decimal point as well and on the numbers as well. So this is your backspace key. Everybody can notice, this is your backspace key. Everybody is comfortable? Understanding, these are simple keys. Now, in order to scroll up and down, you have the arrow keys to scroll up and down. So these keys would be required. I'll show you in multiple functions. We'll be using the scrolling up and scrolling down key over here. Along with that, you have the second key, which kind of works like a shift key. The shift key which you used to use in your scientific calculator. If I want to press an equal to, it's an equal to. If I want to press an answer, which is marked above the equal to button, I have to press second equal to. If I want to use the factorial sign above the multiplication sign, if you notice, I press multiplication button, it's a multiplication sign. But if I press a second multiplication button, it'll be the factorial given to me on the screen. So second button is working like your shift button. So on the button key, you press the button. Above the button, if you want to access, you press second and then the requisite button. Everybody comfortable till here? These are the basic keys. If you want to store certain value, enter certain value somewhere, your enter key works. If you want to store certain value, your enter key works. Where you want to enter something, where you want to impress on something, you want to store some value inside something, your enter key will work. There are places wherein the enter key would not be required. We'll be looking into that as well. Everybody comfortable till here? In the next one, if you see, the basic functions, your digits are here. Your plus, minus, multiplication, division, equals to is here. One function would be this plus minus sign, you understand. If I write 5 minus, that is 5 minus 3 you would be doing. But if I want to make 5 as a negative number, the plus minus button would make the value negative or change the sign. So that is what this plus minus button would be doing. Everybody comfortable? These are easy buttons. You already know all these things. All right. Now let me start off with the most basic functions. Let me explain these portions, this grid over here. Let me explain these buttons first. So say for example, I want to do a 5 to the power 3. So 5 to the power button, the button above 9, the y to the power x button to the power 3. And you will not be able to see to the power. You used to get a hex kind of a symbol when you used to use a scientific calculator, but you can't use that over here. You press equals to and you get a 5 to the power 3. Say for example, I want to do 8 to the power 3. So 8 to the power 3 equals to, you get the answer. Let's say if I want to do 8 to the power 1/3. So when I want to do 8 to the power 1/3, I need to get the answer to. I press 8 to the power. There are two options. I can press 3. When you press the reciprocal button, it does not make the reciprocal of the whole 8 to the power 3. It just gives you the reciprocal of the number on the screen. So right now the number on the screen was 3, so it is going to give the reciprocal of whatever is on the screen. I keep pressing this and I get the reciprocal on the screen. I press equals to and then it becomes 8 to the power 1/3. I'll just repeat this: 8 to the power 3 1 by x equals to, right? And say for example, I wanted to do 8 to the power 2/3. In that case, 8 to the power within brackets 2 divided by 3, bracket close. The moment you close the bracket, you are able to see the value which is there inside the bracket. That is, 2 divided by 3 gets evaluated. When I press equals to, the answer 4 is on the screen. Once I press equals to, the answer 4 is on the screen. Are we all okay? Are we all comfortable till here? Alright, so that is your brackets. So when you're using brackets, you will not be able to see the bracket on the screen. Say for example, I want to do, let's say, 9 plus within bracket 8 divided by within bracket 4 minus 2 bracket close. 4 minus 2 gets evaluated, 8 divided by 2 gets evaluated once I press bracket close, and again when I press bracket close, 9 plus that happened and I got the answer 13. So you can open and close multiple brackets. You have to be very alert when you're thinking about it. You have to open and close multiple brackets. You have to imagine those brackets in your brain, in your mind, and then execute the function. So as and when you close a bracket, say for example 8 divided by within bracket 4 plus 4, when I close the bracket, the value 8 comes out, so bracket close. So when I'm doing, say for example, if I'm doing a 8 divided by 4, bracket open, which you can't see, 4 plus 4. The moment I close bracket, the screen shows me 8. The moment I press equals to, it gives me 1. So that is how the brackets are going to be working. So you have to be very alert when you're using the brackets part. Everybody comfortable till here? Everyone sure? So you could use 2, 3, 4, 5 brackets, and that is only going to come through practice. So in case you are finding an error, in case you are falling short in any place, all you need to do is take a random example like the one I took over here, 8 plus 4 divided by 4. Use a huge bracket, create a Bodmas equation, 8 plus 4 divided by bracket open, 3 plus 1 divided by bracket open. So just make a long one and see if you are getting the relevant answer. And that's how you'll understand whether you are correctly using the brackets or not using the brackets well. Everybody comfortable till here? And then just the way we can make the reciprocal of whatever is given on the screen, I can make the square or square root of whatever is given on the screen. So say for example I want to do 4 into 2 square. The answer should be 16. 4 into 2 square. The square button will make, just the way this reciprocal button was working, similarly the square button will square whatever is on the screen and you get the answer 16. Similarly 4 into 4 square root equals 2. So whatever is on the screen, that will get either square rooted, squared, reciprocal, and this is the power button. And these are the brackets which you could use. Is everybody comfortable over here? Now certain basic functions in math, say for example, I want to do, let's say 5 factorial. 5, second button, and the factorial button is over here. I press factorial and your answer 120 is on the screen. 5 factorial is 120. Say for example, I want to do 5C2. 5 combination, permutation combination. I'll press 5. Second C is on this button. C2 equals to, and that gives me 5C2, that is permutation combination NCR. And if I want to do a permutation, 5 second P is given on the minus sign, P2 equals to, that gives you the permutation part for it. Right, everyone? Understood? X factorial, NPR, NCR. Everybody is comfortable till here? Say for example, I press CC. Now, I forgot to copy the answer. The equals to, the answer written on the equals to button is going to help you do that. You press second and answer, whatever was the last calculated answer appears on the screen. So just in case by mistake you press a CEC, second answer is going to recall the last equated answer on the calculator screen. Are we comfortable till here? Alright, now say for example, let me get into the time value of money buttons. Now you might be having this particular row on your calculator in a different color. If you see, there is a little grid that has been made within which the calculator has placed these 5 buttons over here. Now these 5 buttons are going to be working absolutely separately from the calculator. So if I want to clear all the values within these 5 buttons, if you notice on the FV button, you have a clear TVM written. The clear TVM stands for clear time value of money. I'll press second and FV, and everything stored inside these values will get set to 0. A default value 0, it is all going to be cleared out. Everybody with me on this? Alright, after that, I'll start entering. N is the number of periods, not the number of years. I by Y is the rate per period. PV is the present value. PMT is a regular amount that you need to deposit, that's your annuity amount, and FV is the future value. It is possible you have only a present value and future value and nothing in PMT. You may not enter PMT in that case. It is possible you have a regular annuity with no future value right now and you want to calculate PV, you can ignore FV. So you might be inputting 3 values or 4 values and getting the answer for the fourth value or the fifth value. In the section of bonds, you are going to be generally entering 4 values and trying to get the fifth one out of it. Let's say we are talking about a $1,000 bond. So 1,000 becomes your face value, your future value and face value both. I'll just press F. The moment you press FV, it gets stored into the FV bracket and you see FV equals to 1,000 on the screen. That says that FV has been stored. You don't need to press enter over here because as I told you that these three, this line, the third line over here, NI by Y, PV, PMT is going to be a separate function from the whole calculator. Now next I enter, say for example it's a 9% coupon, payment, 9% coupon payment semi-annually. That means you're going to be paying a $90 coupon on a semi-annual basis. That means it's going to be a 45 payment per annum, per 6 months. So you will enter 45. I don't have to press CEC. Once this FV has stored, I can directly start typing. I typed 45, I press PMT and it gets stored. And it gets stored automatically. I don't have to press the button enter. Then the next one is going to be, let's say the required yield is 8% per annum compounded semi-annually. 8% per annum compounded semi-annually, because you need to use a semi-annual yield. I by Y is going to stand for the rate per period. So semi-annually, 8% semi-annually means 4 is going to be your I by Y. The moment I press I by Y, it gets stored. I don't have to press CEC and then start storing. Say for example, it's a 10 year bond. Now I press 10 and I press enter. That is wrong, because N stands for number of periods, not the number of years. So if it is a semi-annual bond, I am supposed to be entering 20. Now you don't have to delete all the values. You don't have to do a second and FV and then do the work. What you could do is you could again type 20 and press N, and the whole thing gets overwritten. So any mistake you're making, you can always overwrite. Say for example, I forgot to do clear work and I started saving the data. I've saved the data in 3 buttons, and let's say my FV was 0. You can always type 0 and press FV, and your data will get overwritten. So you don't have to delete all that you entered, again do a clear TVM and again start entering values in the buttons over here. Everybody with me? And suppose I'm supposed to be computing PV. All I do is compute PV. The CPT button stands for the term compute. So CPT button is compute basically. CPT button on the first button on the left side is compute. Compute PMT, a PV, gives you the present value. Right? Now if you notice, your present value is turning out to be with a minus sign, and your FV and PMT was with a positive sign. Calculator needs to know whether the cash flows are an inflow or an outflow. So you need to mark the cash flows with the opposite sign. Now suppose I am a bond purchaser. I will be paying 1067 right now to purchase the bond, and the company is going to be in turn giving me 45 and 1000 at the end. So 45 and 1000 is an inflow for me. I place that as a positive sign, and minus 1067 is an outflow for me, because I have to pay this amount to purchase the bond. And when you're talking about from the company's point of view, 1067 would be the positive cash flow for the company. So if I enter and 1000 would be the negative cash flow for the company. 1045 would be the negative cash flow for the company. And when I compute PV, I get exactly the same answer without the negative sign, because the company is receiving 1067 today and the company is paying 45 and 1000 later. So when you're looking at these values, the outflows and inflows need to be of the opposite sign. It doesn't matter as to what sign you are placing for which cash flow. Outflows and inflows, the outflows and inflows need to be of the opposite sign. That is what you need to remember over here. Everybody comfortable till here? The next portion is your annuity portion, wherein I'm expecting the cash flows to be occurring at the beginning of the period. Say for example, if the cash flows are occurring at the beginning of the period, and then you want to calculate the value, right? In that case, you have to set the calculator for a beginning mode. Now if you notice on the word PMT, you have the term written BGN. BGN stands for beginning mode. If you want the calculator to assume that the cash flows are happening at the beginning of the period, second PMT, you see end is written, you need to do second enter. Until unless you press second enter, you do not get the BGN mode stored on the calculator. The moment you do that, if you notice, a very small BGN word alphabet appears on the top right of the screen over here. If you see in very small, you have the BGN mode appearing on the screen. You switch on the calculator, and the BGN mode does not go away. So that is why when I'm doing the time value of money session with you all, I demonstrate how without using the BGN mode, you can do the BGN mode question. Because if you forget to remove the BGN mode over here, the rest of your paper will be solved using the BGN mode. You can set the BGN mode using second PMT, second enter, and you see the BGN mode goes away. The second enter is basically set. So when I'm pressing enter, it is to store values, and above the button enter, you see the word set is written. That set stands for setting something. So second PMT, second enter is the setting the BGN mode. And if you see, the BGN mode appears, and second PMT, second enter is going to remove the BGN mode. Switching off and switching on the calculator will not do the trick. Now say for example, I have set the beginning mode and and I'm not being able to remove it for whatsoever reason, or there is something wrong with my calculator, what you could do is there is a reset word written on the plus minus sign on this button, above this button if you see. Everybody with me? Second reset equals to, and then enter, and when you press enter, it gets back to the factory settings, it gets back to the default settings. So second reset, enter, and back to the factory settings. So you can always reset your calculator back to the factory settings, back to the default settings, right? So in that case also your BGN mode goes. But if you have noticed, my screen has two decimal places now, because by default your calculator screen is going to be having two decimal places. When we are working with percentages, yields, etc., it is advisable that you have six decimal places set on your calculator screen. How do we do that? Second format button, if you see, DC is equal to 2 is given to you. DC stands for decimals. I press 6 and enter, and I get the decimal screens. I get the number of decimal places equals to 6 on the screen. So DC stands for 6. There are other factory settings also. I'll get to it a little later. Please be a little patient. Right? So you can do second reset, enter to set to default settings. You can go to second format button over here, and you can set 6. Enter needs to be pressed in order to get to 6 decimal places. Everybody with me? Comfortable till here? Next, I want to do is, now in the format button, second format, let's see the other varieties. So DEG, if you do, just observe, it's not required, you'll not be using it, it's a useless function for the finance professionals generally. Second enter. So basically, DG stands for degrees, and second enter is basically set. So when I say set, you're not supposed to be doing pressing enter, you're supposed to be pressing second enter. So when I'm giving you instructions as to second enter, second press or something, please understand it's second enter is set. So when I say set, it's automatically second enter. DG stands for degrees, and RAD stands for radians, which we do not need to bother about as such. So I'll just set it back to degrees as it was. I can scroll up and scroll down inside any particular button over here. Everyone, right? I think I pressed another button by mistake. Second format, DEC, degrees or radians. Next comes the date format. The date format will be required in another function, so we need to understand this. When you're looking at the date format, basically 12/31/1990, do you understand it is not DDMMYY, because month cannot be 31? So the US format is MMDDYY. The US format by default is MMDDYY. I can do a second enter to make it a European format where it becomes DDMMNYY. So you can change the format of how you enter the date in the calculator with an MMDDYY or a DDMMYY. So US is going to be, US is MMDDYY, Euro is, Europe is DDMMYY. I personally prefer the DDMMYY format because it becomes easier for me, because I'm used to that particular format. So if you want, you can keep your date changed to the DDMMYY format. Everybody with me on this? You could scroll down, and this one is a kind of a useless one. 1000 is written as 1,000. Over here, if I change to 0, it somehow becomes 1,000, and then there is a comma, and then there is a comma. It is not required, it is not going to be used by you. So I'll set it back to the default, second enter US, and I'll not bother about it. So don't bother about it. There are a lot of functions which we may not be using. CHN and AOS. Please do not change this. Please do not change this. Let it remain to the default CHN. I'll just tell you quickly what it means. CHN means chain. So when I'm doing 2 plus bracket open 1 minus bracket open 3 divided by bracket open 4 divided by bracket close, bracket close, bracket close, etc. If I'm doing a function of this sort, the CHN format is going to do it exactly in the serial order. 1 divided by bracket open, 2 divided by 3. So it'll do 2 divided by 3. Or let's say 1 plus bracket open, 2 divided by 3, bracket close. CHN will do it in the serial order within the brackets the way you're mentioning. And the second AOS is algebraic operating system. AOS stands for algebraic operating system. And that is going to follow BODMAS and all for you. That is going to create confusions. You'll not be sure of your answer. So please don't bother about it. Second enter, I'll keep it to CHN. just because I wanted to cover everything, I'm talking about this, but you're not supposed to be bothering about this part. Everybody with me? So so let's just quickly go through it. DC is decimal places, that is 6. We'll try to set it to that. GD or DG or radians, we'll keep it at default. We don't need to bother about it. Euro, DDMMYY is Euro, MMDDYY is US. I will personally try to keep it DDMMYY, it depends on you. US, we'll keep it as it is, we'll not bother. And CHN, we'll keep it as it is, we'll not bother. Second, enter is used to set the modes. Everybody comfortable with this much? Everybody comfortable with this much? Everyone sure? Alright. Moving forward. Let me do a few easy sections, let's say. Second, RAND. If you see on the divide button, you have the term RAND written, which stands for random. So the moment I click second RAND, it generates any random number between 0 and 1. See, it generates a random number between 0 and 1. So this is going to be required when we study simulations and all. You will understand that random numbers needs to be generated. So the second RAND is going to generate random numbers. Again, you're not going to be using it as such. Then just a second. Alright, then a couple of more basic stuff. Say for example, if I'm talking about the date function over here. On top of 1, if you see, there is a date function given. Second, date. You see, date 1 and date 2 is given. And then you have the DBD and actual. So basically what happens, you need to enter date 1 and date 2. And it will give you the days between dates. DBD stands for days between dates. And there are two formats. Say for example, now I have the DDMMYY format. 31st, let's say we'll talk about today's date. Today's date is, let's say, 25th of June. 25. Just see how I enter the date. There is a format in which you enter the date. 25.0617 will make it. 25.0617. You cannot put 25.06.17. 25.0617 enter makes it 25th of June 2017. 25.06 enter. And then scroll down to the date 2. Let's say I'll leave it 31.12.17. So I want to calculate the number of remaining days in this year. Enter. Scroll down. Days between compute is 189 days. There are 189 days between today's date and 31st of December 2017. I scroll down again and now this is actual days. Suppose I press second enter. You will understand these portions, the requirements in the fixed income section. Suppose I press second enter, it will treat the year to have 360 days and every month to have 30 days. And now I again scroll back and press compute. Instead of 189 days, I have only 186 days. Because every month is being treated as a 30-day month and 360-day year. 30-day month and 360-day year. Then this is the day between dates. And second enter, I can set the actual number of, back to actual number of days. And again scroll down and compute the days between dates. And that gives me 189 days. Everybody comfortable till here? Sure, it is not a very useful function. In the fixed income section, at times when we calculate accrued interest, etc., we use this function. Are we all comfortable till here? All right. Now let's say the second profit. I'm just doing some easy functions quickly so that I can move to the other functions also. Now this is CST, SEL and MAR. It's again another useless function, to be very honest, because you're not going to be using it that often. 100 is my cost. Scroll down. My selling price is 120. Scroll down. Sorry. Second, I by mistake pressed another button. So second, profit again. See, if you do, even if you switch off and switch on your calculator, your numbers will not get deleted. Your values will not get deleted. Arrow down, cost is 100 I entered. Selling price is 120 I entered. Margin compute 16.67%. It is not profit percentage. It is a margin that is given by this one. So cost, selling price, margin you can compute. Say for example, if my margin is equal to 20, enter. What is my selling price? Compute 125. So entering cost, selling price and margin, and that could do the trick. Again, not very useful function. Alright, now if I switch on the calculator, switch off, switch on, and if I go again to the profit, the values have not been removed. If you want to remove the values from any bracket where you have stored, say for example, second date, see the dates that I entered is still over here. If you want to erase any portion, I am inside the date right now. if you see on the CEC button, there is clear work written over here. There is clear work written over here on this button. So all I need to do is second CEC, and you see all the values are stored back to default. I go to second profit. I go inside the profit button, second three profit, second CEC, and everything gets wiped out. So you have to go inside a particular function in order to do delete them. Second CEC is going to do the trick. Second CEC is going to do the trick. Is everybody comfortable till here? But for the NIYY PVPMTFV functions, second TVM will work, second clear work does not work, because you're not going inside anywhere. These buttons are given to you separately because they are very useful functions over here. Are we all comfortable till here, everyone? Sure. Alright, now let me get into a couple of other functions. Let me do another easy one for you. Second, break even. Now in the break even function, fixed cost, variable cost per unit, profit that you require, quantity required will show up over here. Let me say fixed cost is equal to 100, enter. Let me do the example. Variable cost is 2 per unit. Price per unit is, let's say, 3. So basically, its price is 3, variable cost is 2, per unit you are getting 1. So your break-even quantity should be 100. I hope you guys can follow, everyone. The selling price, variable cost is 2, fixed cost is 100, price is 3. So 1 is a contribution per unit and 100 is a fixed cost to be recovered. So if my target profit is 0, what is the quantity required? So you leave the profit as 0. Because target profit is 0 to calculate break-even quantity. You calculate quantity, compute 100 units. Suppose my target profit is 20, enter, my quantity required is 120. Suppose I have 800 quantities being 800 units being sold, profit, compute 700 is the profit for 800 units. So all you need to do is fixed cost, variable cost per unit, price per unit, profit and quantity. There will be one unknown factor which you can calculate. If you are calculating break-even units, please leave the profit to be equal to 0 by default. Are we okay till here? That is break-even. Again, these functions, you are not supposed to be dependent on the calculator. You will be actually faster if you are doing it yourself. Excuse me. Alright. Moving forward, let's say percentage change. Now, old value, new value will give you the percentage change. It's again a very stupid function. 100 is the old value. Let's say 110 is the new value. Enter. I'm over here. Percentage change on the button 5. Right? Scroll down. Percentage change is equal to 10. 100 was P0. 110 is P1. And you get the percentage change. But what if the PD, that is the number of periods is equal to, let's say, 2. In that case, the percentage change is 4.88. Because per period, in 2 periods, 100 became 110. So what is the percentage change per period? So period is the number of periods. If I do, let's say I'll press the percentage sign, it becomes into 1 by 100 plus 1 is equals to this and square. That is equal to 1.10. So it's working. Percentage change is working. Did you see? So I just converted that into the percentage format, plus 1 in whole square. So 1 becomes 1.0488 in 1 period. So in 2 period, 1.10. That is what we calculated in the percentage change. Second ICONV is interest conversion. Second ICONV is interest conversion. These are very easy functions. Most of these you are not going to be using very often. You're not going to be using these very often. Right? But they're easy functions. So let me just show it to you. But try to be faster than the calculator. Don't be dependent. If you can, it's okay. You can practice these functions and use it where required. Like the date function might be still useful in the accrual interest calculation in the bond section. But interest conversion, profit, break even, percentage change, I think you are better off doing it by yourself than on the calculator. It's more irritating and time consuming on the calculator. That is my personal recommendation. Interest conversion, suppose the nominal rate is equal to, let's say, 4%. Going down, and suppose the conversion rate, or let me take the 12, that is easier. 12 is the nominal rate per annum. The conversion, the coupon per period, or the conversion, the amount of times you get interest per period is, let's say, equals to 2. Then you compute the effective rate, 12.36%. If you are going to get it on a quarterly basis, let's say per annum, it's a quarterly basis, effective rate is 12.55. If let's say it's a monthly basis, in that case, your effective rate is equal to 12.68%. Everybody comfortable till here? Everyone easy? This part? Following everyone? So that is your interest conversion. ICONV stands for interest conversion. You press second, ICONV, you have the nominal rate, the effective rate, and the compounding per year. Compounding per year. Everybody okay? Now, for infinite compounding, for continuous compounding, we need to do second, e to the power 0.12. For infinite compounding, we need to do e to the power 0.12. I will have to press 0.12. And if you see on the ln button, you have the e to the power x button written. So second ln will make it e to the power 0.12, and the answer is 1.1275. So 0.12 second ln is going to make it e to the power 0.12. So what is the value of e, say for example, 1 second ln is the value of natural number 2.718282. Are we all comfortable till here? And say I want to find out if 1 becomes 1.10 at the end of 1 year, what is the continuously compounded rate? So 1.10 ln will give me the continuous rates. We have done the proof of these kind of things in our sessions. So 0.095310, if you are continuously compounding at this rate, your value 1 becomes 1.10 at the end of the year. Now say second ln, the answer is 1.10. So log base e is what ln stands for. Ln stands for log base e. Are we all comfortable till here, everybody? Now let me do two new functions for you. There is a CF button, NPV button, and the IRR button over here, if everybody could notice over here. So we have the CF, the NPV, and the IRR buttons over here. I can press on the CF button and it opens the cash flow part. CF stands for cash flow. CF0 is the cash outflow, is a cash flow at time zero. If you are getting a cash flow at time zero, you can enter 0, 100 as the cash flow. If you are paying 100, you can enter 100 as the cash flow. Over here, if I press, say for example 100, I have to press enter in order to store the value. If suppose by mistake I entered this value, you can press a minus sign, you see the equal to disappeared. You have to press enter in order to store the value. In case you do not have a cash flow at time 1, let the CF0 be equal to 0. If suppose you do not have cash flow at time 0, leave the CF0 to be 0 and scroll down. When you scroll down, you get C01. The first cash flow is, let's say, 100, enter. If you want to do a calculation, let's say 100 plus 5 minus 8 into 2 divide plus 6, etc., and then press enter, C01 is still on the screen. So you can do all the calculations you feel like and then press the button enter. You could do that. Everybody comfortable? You can scroll down, frequency 01. So if the first cash flow, say for example, time 0, the cash flow is 0, time 1, the cash flow is 200, let's say at time 2, 3, 4, the cash flow is 200, you can press 2, 3, 4. So the cash flow is occurring 3 times, you're getting the same cash flow, you enter this one. So if you notice on the timeline, time 0, cash flow is 0, time 1, cash flow is 200, time 2 and time 3 also the cash flow is 200. So when I enter the next C02, it is not C02 because time 1, 2, 3, 200 has been entered. So C02 is technically time 4's cash flow on your timeline. So when I enter, let's say 20, enter. And let's say it happened once. Then again, 50 is my cash flow 3, enter. Happened once. Now suppose there is a 0 cash flow at time 4 at this time period. Basically, it's not time 4. If I were to draw the graph for you, just a second. Let's say suppose we had cash flow 0. Let me also keep it 0 only, time 0, time 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's say this is my timeline. So when I enter CF0, if everybody could notice, when I enter CF0 is 0, C01 is 200 and it is 3 times. That means 200, 200, 200. And then when I'm entering cash flow 2, that is technically not cash flow 2, that is cash flow 4, that is 20. And then when I scroll down, 50 is cash flow 5. Once I scroll down, say for example, cash flow 6 is 0. If you do not enter 0, you will not get to enter cash flow 5. So what I need to do is, I need to press enter, store the value 0 in C04, so as to scroll down and get C05, and let's say that is 200. let's say 200, enter. You cannot enter frequency 3. You cannot enter frequency 4 over here. Please don't make the mistake of entering 4 over here. Because these 200 cash flows, 3 cash flows are happening here. And then you have another another 200 cash flow here. Calculator will otherwise assume 200, 200, 200, 200, then 20, 50, 0. So you cannot just press the frequency the way you feel like. Are we all okay till here? Everybody comfortable? Understood? Sorry. So once the cash flows have been entered, what you need to do is you press the NPV button. When you press the NPV button, it is going to ask you for the rate of interest at which you want to discount the cash flows. I press, let's say, 15, enter. You don't need to enter the interest as a percentage sign. You can enter 15 as 15 itself. You enter 15, scroll down, and you can just press compute and your NPV gets computed. You scroll down, you can press FV, compute, and your NFV, net future value, gets computed. So net present value, net future value. It's possible that net future value is not available on the non-professional version. It doesn't matter. You can just simply have the NPV into 1.15 to the power 6, 7, whatever it was. You could just do that and get the answer done. You could just do NPV into 1.1 to the power R or 1.15 to the power R, 1 plus R to the power R, and get the answer. That will not be an issue. Is everybody comfortable till here? And I can further scroll down and calculate the payback period, which is not available. So I need to enter a cash flow. Let's say 500 was the beginning cash flow, enter. And then when I go to the NPV button, I get the payback period. Because in order to calculate payback period, IRR, etc., you need to have a cash outflow. Otherwise, you cannot compute payback. Then I go again back to the NPV button, keep scrolling down. Payback period compute, discounted payback period compute, and payback period, discounted payback period, in case you don't understand, it's a part of corporate finance that will be taken care of. So in the time in which you're recovering your investment is payback period, the time in which you're recovering the present value of your cash flows is your discounted payback period. You can always press the button IRR and press compute, and it is going to give you the internal rate of return, which stands to be 20.63%. So for the cash flows that you have entered over here, you can always go to IRR and press compute. In case you have some minus cash flows, then pluses, then minuses, you will not be able to calculate the IRR, because you might have a multiple IRR problem or a no IRR problem. So in case you have unconventional cash flows, some negative cash flows, then positives and negatives, the polynomial will not be able to be solved and your IRR will show you an error. Say for example, CF0, let me put a minus enter, let me put a minus enter, and IRR compute. Multiple IRR, so it's giving me one of the options. It was possible over here. Let me go and put this one as minus sign enter and then go to IRR compute. Should show an error, minus 28%. So maybe I have to plan my cash flows better, minuses, pluses, minuses, pluses. It shows an error. It shows an error in that case. Anyways, so IRR and NPV button is okay. If you want to remove these values, second CC to remove all the cash flows. So CF0 is a cash flow at time 0. C01 is a cash flow at time 1. Frequency of cash flow at time 1. In case the frequency is extra, C02 is not cash flow 2. It is after the cash flow 1s and all the frequencies have been taken care of. Also, if you want to see C02 on the screen, you have to first enter C01. If there is no cash flow at time 1, please enter the 0 value so that you can have a C02 option on the screen available. Say a cash flow is starting after 5 years. So C01 is 0 and this is 5 times, and then what I do is the C02 technically becomes the 6th cash flow. So there could be multiple ways of doing the question using the power button or using the NIYYPVPVMTFT function or using the CF function. Are we all comfortable till here? Moving forward, if you notice, there is a button data written above the 7 button. If you see, there is a word term data written above the CF function. Everybody with me on this? I press second data. The moment you press second data, you get an option to enter X01, Y01. After you start entering the data, X01, Y01, X02, Y02 appears. And say for example, I enter a stream of data, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and let's say 10, 8, 6, 4, 2. Let's say these are the values of X and Y. Suppose I want to enter values of X and Y in this format. Now, if you understand with this value, I can calculate the average should be 3 and the average should be 6 over here. Maybe I want to do the summation of x square, summation y square, etc. Maybe I want to find out the correlation between these values, which seems to be minus 1. Maybe I want to find out an equation which is going to be equal to y is equal to a plus bx for this value. Let me find out these values for you. So let me quickly do this. So x0 1 1 enter, scroll down, y0 will be 10 enter, x0 2 was 2 enter, y0 2 was, let me enter x first, 3, scroll down, 4, scroll down, 5, enter. Let me go back, y0 1 was 10, 8, 6, 4, 2. If you want to see what you've entered, you can always scroll up and down and see what values you have been entering. You can always scroll up and down and check the values that you have entered. Everybody comfortable? We go to second stat. LIN stands for linear equation. LIN stands for linear equation. Arrow down. N is equal to 5, the number of observations. We entered 5 values. Average of x is 3. Average of standard sample SD of x is 1.58. That is when you use the formula summation x minus x bar, whole square divided by n minus 1 square root. That is Sx. When you use the value n in the denominator, that is going to be your standard deviation population. Scroll down, you get the average of y, sample SDY, population SDY, a plus bx, 12 and minus 2. Try this, 10 minus 12 minus 2 into 1 is 10, 12 minus 2 into 2 is 8, 12 minus 2 into 3 is 6. So you have the equation of y equals to ax plus b on the screen. You have the equation y equals to ax plus b, the value a and b on the screen. Correlation is minus 1. Say for example, if my value of x is equal to 10, what is going to be the value of y? So you can enter x in the equation and you can calculate the value of y. So if my x is equal to, let's say 5, enter, value of y is equal to 2, x is equal to 5, value of y is equal to 2. Over here the correlation is absolutely equal to minus 1, but if your correlation is 0.8 or something, even then the regression equation will work. So you have formed the equation y equals to ax plus b, you enter a value of x over here and you get the value of y over here. You can easily compute that. Summation x, summation x square, summation y square, summation xy. So all these values are available to you. And also, just a moment, just a second please. Just give me a second. Yes. So now, just a moment. Alright, so now instead of having my equation work, suppose my y is equal to a plus bx. Suppose y is equal to a plus b ln of x. It's a linear equation, logarithmic equation. Suppose y is equal to a b to the power x. Suppose y is equal to a x to the power b. Can you see these formats? Second, enter. Linear, logarithmic to the natural number, exponential, power function. So these are the four formats in which you can calculate the equation. Y is equal to A plus BX is what we calculated right now. Suppose you want to enter the values of A and B. Suppose you want to enter the values of Y and X and you want the equation Y is equal to A plus B ln X. Y is equal to A plus B to the power X. Y is equal to A into X to the power B. If you want these kind of formats for the equation, you will be supposed to be choosing. When we are doing second stat, you need to second enter. You can choose any of the options over here. So when you understand trends, maybe CFA level 2, FRM level 1, you will be encountering logarithmic trends and seasonality, cyclicality, those kind of areas, these functions will be useful. Although we generally stick to the linear one, the rest of it does not come into a lot of use, but still no harm knowing. it's not going to be all that great. Now you remember, I'll just quickly revise. You need to remember the CF function. You need to remember the enter, the arrows, the on and off. You need to definitely remember the CF, NPV, IRR. You definitely need to know the NI by Y, PV, PM, TFV. You need to know the BGN mode and the clear TVM. You need to know the percentage, root X, X square, etc. You need to know all these functions. Random, not very important. I'll get back to this. And the numbers you already understand. You definitely need to understand the data and the stat part. Data is where you enter the data, second 7 you enter the data, and the stat part is where you are finding out all the observations, all the answers. Second enter. You can keep scrolling down and get all the values over here. That is how you use the stat. The break even, not very important. Percentage change, not very important. Profit margin, not important. Interest conversion, not important. Date, you should be using. Because in calculating accrual interest and all, the number of days between the dates, whether be it a 360-day period or a actual by actual, it's going to be quite useful. Format and reset, we've covered. You need to understand that. I hope we are more or less like quite comfortable with a lot of functions on the calculator. And it is going to take time and practice. Take random values, try to find the answer and see if you're getting the correct answer. And then you can take the complicated answers. Say, for example, 8 to the power 1/3. Try to calculate that in your own way. Everybody with me? Now say I've got the 5 on the screen. I can do second. Sorry. Alright, let me do it this way. Let me show you another function. I'm trying to cover everything so that you know you guys are comfortable, you know all the functions. You may use certain functions more frequently, and some functions will not be coming into that much use. Now say for example we have the function round. Now if I do a 2, let's say, let me set the calculator reset, sorry, second format 2 enter. Let me set the calculator to 2 decimal places. It might not be very relevant for you, just have a look. 2 divided by 3 is equal to 0.67. If I multiply by 3, the answer should be equals to exactly 2. That is working out. Now, 2 divided by 3 equals to second round. Second STO is rounding off. So basically what now the number on the screen is equal to 0.67. It's not equals to 0.666666. So you have rounded off to the number of decimal places on the screen. So if you had 6 decimal places, the number would have been rounded off to 6 decimal places. Now if I do into 3, you see the answer is 2.01 and not 2. So 2 divided by 3 into 3 is 2. But 2 divided by 3 second STO, that is round, is 2.01. Because it has rounded off the number to the number of decimal places on the screen. Comfortable, everyone? Second format 6 enter. Let me get back to my 6 decimal places. So that is a round function. Everybody comfortable? All right. Now, say suppose I did some calculation, 10 plus 5 equals to, and I got the answer 15. With the value 15, second STO, sorry, again I made a mistake, sorry again, 15. Some suppose I did a 10 plus into 5, 50, let's say, STO 1 equals to. Just a second, I think I'm going wrong. I do not use the store function regularly. I'd rather use the brackets function. So suppose I have 10 into 5 equals to, I press store, I press 1, enter. So that means you've stored 50 value in the digit 1 in the first place. Let me again do it. Let me try 80 plus 5, 85, store 2, enter. So I have 50 and 85 in 1 and 2. What if I want to add 50 and 85? Recall 1 plus recall 2 equals to 135. So STO stands for store and RCL stands for recall. So you can store the values. Let me try another one. 5, store 3, enter. So I've stored 5 over here. Now what I want to do is recall 1 plus recall 2 divided by recall 3 equals to 27. So you can store the numbers in this. So you press store, you do your calculation on the screen, you press store 1, 2, 3, wherever you want to store, in whichever digit you want to store, and press enter, it gets stored. And recall that number, so it will recall whatever is stored inside that number. Are we all comfortable till here? Everyone? Easy? All right. Then let me show you a little. Let me just see if I've covered all the important sections. Yes, I'm more or less done with most of the important ones. Let me just do a couple of few not so important ones, and we'll move forward. Now look at sine cos tan. You're not going to be using it. Say for example 45 second tan. It gives you one, and because my format, if you see, was set to degrees format, not radians. So 45 is equal to 1. And if you want to use sine cos tan, you can do that. We'll not be needing it for finance generally. If you want to do the inverse of these sine cos tan, in that case I'll type 45 inverse of tan. Second tan. So basically 45 degrees, inverse of 45 degrees, inverse of 1 is equal to 45. So 1, sorry, I think it was supposed to be 1. Inverse of tan is 45. Yeah, it was correct. So I type 1. 1 was the tan 45 is 1. Inverse of 1 is equal to tan inverse of 1 is equal to 45 degrees. So I press 1. Inverse of tan is equal to 45. 1 inverse of sine is equal to 90 degrees. HYP, second inverse, stands for hyperbole. So that is not required. We are not going to be using that. So that is a hyperbole for these function. Anyways, you're not even going to be using sine cos tan, so don't bother about it. Everybody comfortable till here? Moving to the next one, there is this depreciation function on the button 4. It's not very handy, not advisable to be used, because when you're studying depreciation, it's better you study, you work on the depreciation by yourself. Say suppose second depreciation, you have multiple options. You have, just a second, say for example, just a second, all right. So you have multiple options. Second SL is straight line method, sum of years digits method, declining balance method with something with crossover. This is going to be straight line method French. This is declining balance French. This is again the straight line method. So there are varieties of depreciation. You are not going to be using it, because even I have to refer to the short forms, the meaning of the short forms over here, because I don't use these shortcuts, because it's easier to use depreciation by yourself. So depreciation is a function. You're not going to be using it. I'm just doing my bit to just give you an introduction as to what it does, because you know, you might feel curious about knowing these functions. Some people don't, but anyways, so say for example, I'm using the straight line method, easiest to do the calculation. The life is 10 years. Let's say month 01. Try to ignore this one. Basically, it tells you from which month you start using this asset. Suppose I start putting this asset to use from the 6th month. So then I'll enter 6. So 6 months onwards, you're going to have the depreciation begun. So I will depreciate it from the first month itself. The cost of asset is, let's say, 100, enter. The salvage value is 10, enter. So that means I'm depreciating 19 10 years. The depreciation should be year 1, the depreciation is 9. The reduced balance value, the reduced remaining book value is equal to 91, 100 minus 9. RDV stands for, I'll have to check just a second, because again, RDV is remaining depreciable value. So remaining depreciable value is 81, because 100 was your cost, 10 is your salvage value. You're supposed to be depreciating 90, out of which you've depreciated, remaining book value is 91, out of which you've depreciated 9. So out of that, you're left to depreciate only 81. 81 is the remaining depreciable value. That is in year 1. Let's say year 5, enter. Year 5, your depreciation is 9, your remaining book value is 55, you've depreciated 45, and the remaining depreciable value is only 45, because 10 is salvage value. This is the situation in year 5. Year 9, enter. You're left to depreciate 9. Your balance, your reduced book value is 19, remaining book value, and the remaining depreciable value is only 9, because beyond that you can't depreciate, your salvage value will become 10. Bolo. Everybody is comfortable till here. So this is your depreciation bit, and you're not going to be using this that often. So don't worry about it. Last one, second bond. second bond. Now the bond becomes a little difficult to understand and do the work over. Anyways, let's try and understand this. Let me take, say for example, SDT stands for settlement date, because again we will be using this ourselves. We'll be manually doing it rather than using the calculator. Settlement date is SDT. Coupon is going to be the amount of coupon. RDT is going to be redemption date, that is a maturity date of the bond. RV is going to be standing for your redemption value, the percentage of par value. I'll do a sum and I'll work it out for you. Let me just start off. Let's say I want a bond to be maturing on, let's say today is 25th of June 2017. And let's say the bond is going to be maturing on, let's say 31st December 2035. Right? So now let me try to get these values on the screen for you. Alright. So the settlement date is 31, full stop, 1235. Right? Enter 31/12/2005 is a settlement date. No, that is a redemption date. Sorry, my mistake. I'll rectify it. 31.1235, 31st of December 2015 is your redemption date. Start settlement date, that is, we are talking about today. Settlement, when we are buying, purchasing, selling the bond, that is 25.0617 is your settlement date. Coupon is going to be, let's say the coupon is going to be entered as, just a moment, let's say 9% semi-annually. I'll enter coupon as 9. Redemption value is going to be, let's say 1000, because 1000 is going to be my face value that I'll be recovering at redemption. Now, is it going to be the payment? Will the coupons, be paid on an actual day basis or a 360 day basis? Second, enter, that is set. You can set the actual number of days or this much days. Let me keep it actual. Everybody with me, scroll down. Is it the coupon is going to be semi-annually or one annual payment? One per year or two times per year? Right? Semi-annual. Let's go down. Yield. For computing yield, I need to write yield so that I know the price of the bond, or I need to put in the price in order to compute. Second bond. Settlement date. Today I'm purchasing the bond. The coupon is this. The redemption date is this. Recoverable amount is this. Redemption value, actual days, semi-annual. Now either you put yield and get the price, or you put the price and you get the yield. You have to enter one. Let's say I put 9% as the, I had put 9% I believe as the coupon, right? Yes. So let me put 8% as the yield. My bond value should be higher in that case, more than 1000. Enter, compute. There's some problem. Accrued interest is 4.37. Accrued interest is 4.37 for these 5 days remaining. Just a second. Just a moment. I have to keep it 100. We'll have to keep the redemption value as 100. You have to do the calculations for 100 par value, because the coupon I entered, please understand over here, please over here. So I entered was 9. So the coupon is 9 per annum. So that is a $9, not the percentage terms. In case I enter this as 90 and then I enter the redemption value as 1000. If I enter the coupon 90 and redemption value as 1000, and the yield is 9, then the price is fine. But if I enter the coupon as 9, in that case the redemption value has to be on a base of 100, and then I can get the price. Let's say the yield is 8% and then the price is 109.57. Everybody following this part? You enter yield, you get the price. You enter price, you get the yield. Let me put the price over here and calculate yield. That is 8.99, just a bit of rounding of error. Everybody is comfortable. Also, there is something called duration, which you'll study later, and the duration gets computed automatically in the bond. So duration will be covered in the fixed income section, and the duration gets automatically calculated for you. Are we all comfortable till here? Everybody comfortable? Everything? I think we've covered more or less all the functions over here. Just a second, let me just cross check if we've covered everything. also, if you would notice, second MEM, you have M0, M1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So whatever values you entered, see if you remember, we entered 85, 50, 85 and M3. We in the button 3, we entered 5. So all the values that you've entered in the memory from 0 to 9, you can enter 10 numbers over here from 0 to 9, second MEM, and all the values get entered, get stored over here. So 87, whatever it is, plus 8, whatever is the answer, store, let's say 8, enter. So I have stored it in 8, I can recall 8, sorry, I can recall 8 and the answer comes up, and I can also go to second MEM and see if you scroll down, I have the value 8 over here. So all the memory, whatever you've stored, is appearing over here. So basically, if you notice, I have not done the hyperbole part because that's not required. That's high level, into trigonometry and all those things. So we'll not need this. Now, the only thing that I've left is the word k over here. X, p by y, p by y and amort. Other than that, I think we've covered every single function on the calculator. Is everybody comfortable over here? Right now, these functions, the amortization, p by y, x, p by y and k, I would rather request you to ignore because it becomes very tedious. Basically, when you have mortgage installments or EMIs to be paid, the principal portion, the interest portion can be calculated using these. Once we start off, once you're comfortable with the calculator, we may look at that. But just the way depreciation, break-even, percentage change, profit, we don't use these functions. Date functions you could use. Store function you could use if you feel like. CF, NPV, IRR, data, stat you need to be comfortable with. All these square root, x square, 1 by x, to the power, MCR, NPR, etc. Answer, reset, format. So I think you're more or less comfortable with every single button, and I'm not spending more time over here on the amort, p by y and x p by y because it's a little complicated to use and there is more chances of making an error. So we can calculate the EMI payments, the principal and the interest component of an installment by ourselves. I hope everybody is comfortable, everybody understood every single function of the calculator. Use dummy random easy values. Let's say I'll calculate the present value of 10, 10, 10, 10 for 4 years and I see the answer. I'll do the calculation using this way also. 10 divided by 1.1, sorry, 10 divided by 1.1 plus bracket open 10 divided by 1.1 square bracket close plus, so you know, do it this way, then again using ni by y pvpmt, then using the cf function, take simple values, try to get the answer in multiple ways, try to get a 8 to the power 1/3, 8 to the power 2/3 using brackets and all, create a complex equation like 8 to the power 2/3 plus 4 to the power half plus 27 to the power 2/3, you know, and use multiple brackets and see, because you can manually, you can mentally calculate these answers and see if the way you're using the brackets and doing the calculations, is it fine or not. Bolo, are we, everybody, all of us, are we comfortable till here? Are we all okay with the calculator? Everyone, sure, we'll just need to put in a little practice over here. So that completes your calculator session. Thank you so much. We stop here.